This is Delhi. Please stand by for our special broadcast. This is All India Radio. We take great pleasure in welcoming our listeners to the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture 2021. These lectures, beginning from 1955, are an annual feature organized by All India Radio, commemorating the birth anniversary of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, known as the Iron Man of India. Sardar Patel, one of the key integrating forces of the nascent nation and an integral part of India's independence movement, was also Free India's first Minister of Information and Broadcasting. Tonight, we bring you this year's Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture, delivered by the Chief of Defence Staff of India, General Bipin Rawat, PVSM, UYSM, AVSM, YSM, SM, VSM, ADC, on the topic, The Role of the Indian Armed Forces in Nation Building.
I would like to begin my talk today with a quote from Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Take to the path of Dharma, the path of truth and justice. Don't misuse your valor. Remain united. March forward in all humility. But be fully awake to the situation you face, demanding your rights and firmness. We worked hard to achieve our freedom. We shall have to strive harder to justify it. I unquote. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed an honor for me to be invited to deliver the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture this year, organized by Prasar Bharati in memory of the visionary role model for many, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, who is fondly remembered as the Iron Man of India. Many eminent leaders, visionaries, economists, scientists, historians, intellectuals, judges and policy makers have spoken in the past at this annual event since 1955. Being the first uniformed soldier to speak at this event is indeed a privilege, and I shall dwell on a topic close to my heart, that is, role of Indian Armed Forces in nation building. Realizing that no nation state can be built without first creating and inculcating nationalism, Sardar Patel had envisioned an Indian nation united in our diversity, resolute and determined to emerge as a power capable of rising to any challenge based on our internal strength. The Indian paradox is that though we are an ancient society and civilization, we are made to believe that we are a new nation state in the modern political sense. Historically, we are all aware India has been a conglomerate of closely linked smaller kingdoms that have been merged into larger kingdoms spanning from Persia, that is, present-day Iran, to the Burmese hills in present-day Myanmar. During the Mauryan Empire, in the Gupta Age and the Mughal period, the British Indian colonial empire somewhat changed the discourse of our historical past through misinterpretations and misrepresentations of our legacy. The dynamics of these near whole or complete Indian nation states have been that each time it has risen out of a hotbed of internecine wars and in fighting amongst each other. As a nation state, India comprises myriad streams of culture, 22 scheduled languages, over 200 dialects, a dozen ethnic groups, 7 religious communities with several sects and subsects, with 68 socio-cultural sub-regions. That makes us a very diverse and exalted society, but concurrently adds a whole range of complexities as a society and the nation. This very paradox also poses challenges in building India as a nation. The concept of nation states today represents the citizens' aspirations to be grouped as a single political unit that would in turn act as an instrument towards achieving quality life through liberty and happiness. Ladies and gentlemen, What is nation building? Is it economic development and industrialization? Is it building large metros, roads, schools and hospitals? Is it ensuring social equality and harmony? Or is it shaping a national identity based on our core values so as to mature as a strong and vibrant nation? Proud and confident, backed by comprehensive national power to assume its rightful role in international affairs. In my opinion, nation building is a combination of all facets of progress. This is the ultimate goal in nation building. This is also stated in the preamble of our constitution. In the contemporary world order, the pillars of nation building could be surmised as security, justice, economic development, and democratic polity. Security comes first in the pecking order because a secure internal and external environment is a prerequisite for the other three pillars to function effectively. In all this, it is important that every citizen consider themselves as an Indian first and takes the pledge of nation first and everything else later, respects the national flag and vows never to allow our nationality to be ever compromised. The Indian Armed Forces have played a sterling role in national consolidation from the day one of India's independence. Sardar Patel had immense faith in the institution of the Armed Forces of India. It was his vision that he sent the newly formed Indian Navy to Lakshadweep to consolidate our territory as Pakistan had plans to occupy the strategic islands sitting astride the important sea lanes of communication in the Indian Ocean and the Arabian Sea in particular. The quintessential visionary that Sardar Patel was, he had assertively voiced the need of an independent Tibet as a buffer state between India and China, as can be found in his correspondence with the then Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. Further, no one had fathomed that the scale of mayhem due to communal frenzy that was unleashed by the partition of our nation, the large-scale violence between people who once lived as one community, resulted in loss of thousands of innocent lives. In 1947, the police force was limited in numbers, not fully trained or equipped, and was suffering from the trauma of communal fighting. The communal frenzy was at that time beyond the control of the police. The armed forces were then called in to control the furious rioting and enforce civil order. It was during this time that Sardar Patel, as Deputy Prime Minister of India and also the first Home Minister and Minister of States, organized relief efforts for refugees fleeing from Punjab and Bengal and worked to restore peace. Some believe that the British left India with a bloodless legal transfer of power. But the birth of the nation state that we see today was not such a smooth affair. Few princely states, mainly Hyderabad, Junagadh and Kashmir, were averse to joining the state of India. Hyderabad and Junagadh had to be coerced to integrate with India by what came to be known as police actions. In October 1947, when Maharaja Harit Singh of Jammu and Kashmir signed the instrument of accession to join India, the armed forces were swiftly inducted into Kashmir Valley and other parts of the state to thwart Pakistan's design of invading it by force. Sardar Patel worked tirelessly to build a consensus with the princely states, but did not hesitate in employing Chanakya's age-old priest methods of Sam, Dam, Bhed and Dand wherever necessary. It is to the credit of Sardar Patel that the integration of the princely Indian states into the Indian Union and the political unification of India took place. His contribution in integrating 565 princely states into a new independent India is unforgettable. Later, the liberation of Goa, Daman and Diu carried forward the consolidation of our territorial frontiers. Sardar Patel was also clearly conscious of the fact that independent India needed a steel frame to run its civil, military and administrative bureaucracy. His faith in institutional mechanisms like having an organized command-based armed forces and a systemized bureaucracy proved to be a blessing. The primary role of the armed forces is to defend the territorial integrity of the nation-state against external and internal threats. Strong and well-trained armed forces provide a credible deterrence to our potential adversaries. If this is achieved, developmental activities and national building can be progressed without external hindrance. This is central to the concept of national security and paramount for all nation-building activities. Territorial ambition of China and Pakistan require India's armed forces to remain alert and deployed along disputed borders and also along the coastal region around the year. History is witness to the fact that whenever a nation has neglected its armed forces and their capacity, external powers have been quick to exploit it. In the 1950s, we overlooked this important lesson of history and allowed the security apparatus to drift till the Chinese shook us up in 1962. We had to relearn this lesson through an ignominious experience. Post 1962, we have had several skirmishes against the Chinese. At Nathula in Sikkim in 1967, Wangdung in 1986, Doklam in 2017, and the recent skirmishes in eastern Ladakh. The outcomes have made it clear that the Indian Armed Forces are alert and determined to defend national territory. This feedback has helped the Chinese and our leaders to pursue agreements for maintaining peace and tranquility along the line of actual control and several other confidence-building measures to improve relations. Pakistan attempted to disrupt our national integrity and annex part of our territories in major attacks in 1965, 1971, and later in 1999. In all these conflicts, it was effectively defeated. In 1984, the armed forces preempted the Pakistan Army's effort to illegally occupy the Siachen Glacier, which many other minor intrusions and skirmishes along the line of control too have been effectively foiled. In addressing the contribution of Indian armed forces in nation building, the starting point lies in understanding India's military legacy. Military history, in its outlook and purpose, is heavily dependent on traditions of service imbibed over years of our blood-stained history. These traditions, almost sacred to soldiers, can be traced upwards to patriotism and downwards to self-pride. These traditions date back to the days of the Mahabharata. The Bhagavad Gita says, "Considering your own duty, you shall not waver." In the same lines, all cadets of Indian Military Academy, before culminating their training, take allegiance to the oath, which reads, "The safety, honor, and welfare of your country come first, always and every time. The honor, welfare, and comfort of the men you command come next. Your own ease, comfort, and safety come last, always and every time." An oath is the bedrock of the true military profession, which differentiates it from all other professions. Earlier, the oath was based on the concept of Naam, Namak, and Nishan. Be honorable, true to your salt, and uphold the flag. Today, this oath is to the Constitution of Democratic India. The armed forces are a true reflection of the basic national concept of unity in diversity. In an exemplary role model for the rest of our countrymen, soldiers of all classes, castes, creed, and religion are able to serve the nation with total dedication, living together in barracks, eating from the same kitchen, speaking the same language, and observing each other's religious festivals. Secularism, ladies and gentlemen, discipline, integrity, loyalty, esprit de corps are essential values inculcated among our men. Such motivated people not only make efficient and dedicated soldiers in service, but even after leaving the services, continue as nation-building role models for others. An important legacy of the Indian Armed Forces has been its totally apolitical outlook. As I have stated earlier, a soldier's oath is to the Constitution of India and to the constitutionally elected central government. The ideology of the political parties or their hue and color does not concern the armed forces. Our armed forces, unlike those of some neighboring countries, have stuck to the concept of loyalty to the constitutionally elected government. They have thus contributed to the political stability of the nation and enabled it to develop its unique democratic political ambience. India is a vast country. Some of our people are living in remote border areas far from the Indian heartland. The armed forces have played a significant role in integrating people of these areas and border states into the national mainstream. Many a times, a soldier was the first Indian to reach out to these areas and rekindle the nationalistic and patriotic feeling in the local population. Deployment of the armed forces enabled governmental infrastructure to follow in the remote areas of Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, Manipur, Nagaland, border areas of Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, and parts of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. Till the late 1950s, the important Buddhist town of Tawang had very little administrative links with India. The civil government representatives were located many miles short at Bomdila. Even today, most Indians do not know where places like Mon, Moray, Gyaogong, Taksing or Vijayanagar are located. The credit for initiating the feeling of nationalism in such areas goes to the armed forces. The very establishment of a military station generates a certain amount of business and developmental activities in and around the station. This is how the government's developmental infrastructure like roads, electricity and telecommunication could reach out to remote and undeveloped areas. The armed forces have also improved the ecology of the areas wherever they are located. The greening of the cantonments and the forestation undertaken by the Ecology Territorial Army battalions in Uttarakhand, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and other states has set a healthy trend for others to follow. There is no better example of unity in diversity than the armed forces. Unaffected by divisive politics or casteist social activities, military stations have always been and are totally cosmopolitan oases of national unity. The Indian Armed Forces have scrupulously maintained the ideals enshrined in our constitution. The economic progress that the country has seen over the past years can be attributed to a relatively peaceful environment achieved by the steadfast commitment of our armed forces on the borders and internally. Our ingrained spirit of nationhood have played a significant role in fostering the spirit of inclusive growth. In every essence, the Indian Armed Forces have executed their mission with the spirit of Har Kaam Desh Ke Naam. I shall now seek to highlight some of the other significant areas where the Indian Armed Forces play a stellar role in nation building and where in the coming years they portend a larger role for them to shape the destiny of our nation. With a combatant manpower of nearly 14 lakh personnel, the armed forces represent motivated, trustworthy, physically and mentally conditioned youth for undertaking challenging assignments. Our personnel imbibe discipline, character, and ideals of selfless service and also have some of the best developed skills, technical, social, leadership, importantly, which are adaptive towards nation-building efforts. Our cantonments in military stations in remote areas have contributed to the local economy through developmental projects, increased connectivity and indirect effects like increase in real estate valuation and so on. The armed forces have played a crucial role in bringing peace to regions where our misguided youth have been swayed by the adversary. In addition to ridding violence and fear of terrorism, human security has been the focus of area through extensive public support, human resource development, seamless supply of essential commodities, etc. The armed forces have been able at the forefront of helping build the country through development initiatives. The untiring efforts of the Border Road Organization by connecting the remote and far-flung areas, by building roads and bridges, aim at integration of the people of our country. Through our military civic actions like goodwill schools, vocational facilities and sporting avenues for the youth in remote and inaccessible areas, we are winning hearts and minds, assuaging the feeling of alienation and molding public opinion towards peace. The National Cadet Corps, which was enacted through an Act of Parliament in 1948, has students from schools and colleges all across India and has wings from all the three services. Out of a total of 721 districts in India, NCC is covered in 716 districts. A total of 17,644 schools and colleges, both government and private, are enrolled in NCC. Further, 8,902 institutions are waitlisted to be enrolled. NCC inculcates the spirit of unity and discipline and has helped in nation building by shaping the youth of the nation into dynamic and responsible citizens of the country. Expansion of NCC is therefore being taken up on priority. The Indian Armed Forces have always done a commendable job when called to aid civil authorities, especially in the wake of natural calamities or man-made disasters, be it within the country or in our neighborhood. The recent evacuation of Indians from Afghanistan by the Indian Air Force and the best practices displayed by a uniformed medical fraternity in fighting COVID-19 has been appreciated by one and all. The Make in India initiative in the military and the defense corridors that are being set up is our priority, and I must acknowledge the commitment of all stakeholders, including the civilian defense industries, which are making adequate headway towards our modernization efforts. DefExpo 2020 has brought leading technologies in the defense sector under one roof, with opportunities for the government, private manufacturers and startups. The economic spin-off to the nation from the success of such ventures needs no amplification, especially when a substantial part of our budget allocations go into import of weapons and systems. We are progressively yet assuredly moving from import dependency towards self-reliance, and finally will move towards export promotion of the best defense technology incorporated weapons and systems. The armed forces have also enhanced India's image abroad. Our forces, in support of the foreign policy of the government, have projected military power to usher peace and for conflict resolution in Bangladesh, Sri Lanka and Maldives when requested by our neighbors. Since the mid-1950s, the armed forces have been deployed in a large number of UN peacekeeping missions all over the world. They have worked in Korea, Congo, Gaza, Cambodia, Angola, Somalia, Rwanda, Namibia, Sudan, and many other countries, and done the nation proud by their impartiality, efficiency, and dedication. This aspect has received international recognition. With numerous shared security challenges between nations, especially of the asymmetric and non-traditional variety, defense cooperation will shape and be shaped by joint efforts in domains of terrorism, cybersecurity, piracy, crime, and humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. Defense cooperation today is being used as an important diplomatic endeavor to find and cement some common ground to such transnational threats. Our Defense Diplomatic Corps is being expanded and their mandate being revised, all in line towards nation building. Lastly, as we transform our forces, our endeavors are aligned towards nation building through the prism of human resource development, equipping technology infusion and international cooperation. We in the armed forces understand the need to fulfill a larger responsibility which reflects the resolve of more than a billion people. The Indian Armed Forces would continue to represent the nation's unique characteristics, which are unity in diversity and the military virtues of sacrifice, loyalty and discipline that have always remained and will serve as objects of veneration for the entire nation. And finally, in conclusion, I would say a nation comprises not just its economic assets, A nation consists of its people, national character and core values, its culture, its unity and its stature in the world community. We need to build India as a nation on the basis of a common ideology, impeccable character and stable institutions so as to help create a strong and powerful nation which can improve the quality of its people. Modern Indian history is incomplete without Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. His vision, dream and his principles had made us stand tall as a proud nation with rich culture and with people as our strength. The Statue of Unity is a humble tribute from the people of this nation to the Iron Man of India. Finally, I would like to reiterate that Armed Forces of India have established and sustained their credibility to dedication, sacrifice, professional competence and operational effectiveness. Besides being defenders of the nation, they are the people's armed forces with recruitment from all parts of the country. The people of India, the most important element in our nation, have looked at them as secular, positive and impartial. The armed forces are proud of this achievement and image, and I am certain that they will carry this spirit in the future too. Thank you and Jai Hind.
You have been listening to the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture 2021, delivered by the Chief of Defence Staff of India, General Bipin Rawat. PVSM, UYSM, AVSM, YSM, SM, VSM, ADC. On the topic, the role of the Indian Armed Forces in nation building. And with this, we conclude our special broadcast, the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture 2021. This broadcast came to you from the Delhi station of All India Radio.